The History of Thanksgiving You Were Never Taught. Chapter 1. Introduction. For most people, Thanksgiving is a holiday to commemorate a big feast shared by pilgrims from England and Native Americans in 1621 to celebrate a great harvest. But Thanksgiving is a holiday with a very complicated and truly fascinating history. Firstly, you need to understand what Thanksgiving really means. Thanksgiving is a national holiday celebrated on various dates in the United States, Canada, Grenada, St. Lucia, and Liberia. It began as a day of giving thanks for the blessing of the harvest and of the preceding year. Similarly named festival holidays occur in Germany and Japan. Thanksgiving is celebrated on the second Monday of October in Canada and on the fourth Thursday of November in the United States and around the same part of the year in other places. Although Thanksgiving has historical roots in religious and cultural traditions, it has long been celebrated as a secular holiday as well. Chapter 2. The Origins of Thanksgiving. Prayers of thanks and special Thanksgiving ceremonies are common among almost all religions after harvests and at other times. The Thanksgiving history in North America is rooted in English traditions dating from the Protestant Reformation. It also has aspects of a harvest festival, even though the harvest in New England occurs well before the late November date on which the modern Thanksgiving holiday is celebrated. In England, in the reign of Henry VIII, days of Thanksgiving and special Thanksgiving religious services became important during the English Reformation. Henry VIII became head of the English Church and England turned Protestant and started introducing church reforms, including the large number of religious holidays on the Catholic calendar. Puritans, who wished to purify church teachings and ceremonies, wished to eliminate all church holidays, including Christmas and Easter. The holidays were to be replaced by specially called days of fasting or days of thanksgiving. Unexpected disasters or threats called for days of fasting. Special blessings, a good harvest for example, viewed as coming from God, called for days of thanksgiving. Days of Thanksgiving were called following the English victory over the Spanish Armada in 1588, and in 1605, following the failure of the gunpowder plot to blow up the government. This day of Thanksgiving developed into Guy Fawkes Day, on November 5. Days of fasting were called on account of drought in 1611, floods in 1613, and plagues in 1604 and 1622. Chapter 3. The Origins of Thanksgiving in North America. Pilgrims and Puritans, who emigrated from England in the early 1600s and wishing to establish a simple form of church worship, carried the tradition of days of fasting and days of thanksgiving with them to New England. The Puritans wished to remain in the Anglican Church and reform it. Pilgrims wanted complete separation from the church. And both went to America in search of religious freedom of worship. Thanksgiving services were routine in what became the Commonwealth of Virginia as early as 1607 when English colonists at Fort St. George assembled for a harvest feast and prayer meeting with the Abenaki Indians of Maine. And in 1610, the first permanent settlement of Jamestown, Virginia, held a Thanksgiving. This is where the story of John Smith and Pocahontas occurred. However, the modern Thanksgiving holiday tradition is traced to a well-recorded event in Virginia in 1619, and a sparsely documented celebration at Plymouth in present-day Massachusetts in 1621, 2 years later. The 1619 arrival of 38 English settlers at Berkeley Hundred in Charles City County, Virginia, concluded with a religious celebration as dictated by the group's charter from the London Company. The London Company was responsible for colonizing the east coast of America, and the charter required, quote, that the day of our ship's arrival at the place assigned, in the land of Virginia, shall be yearly and perpetually kept holy as a day of thanksgiving to Almighty God, unquote. It clearly stated that a holy Thanksgiving day should be held every year, to celebrate their arrival in Virginia. The famous event held in November 1621, which is considered to be America's first Thanksgiving, was held by the so-called Pilgrim Fathers, who sailed from England in the Mayflower ship and arrived in Plymouth, Massachusetts in 1620. The now famous 1621 Plymouth feast and Thanksgiving was prompted by a good harvest of barley. The pilgrims celebrated this with Native Americans, who had helped them get through the previous winter by giving them food in that time of scarcity. Chapter 4. The Feast. The feast lasted 3 days and was attended by 90 Wampanoag Indian natives and 53 pilgrims, mostly children and men. Most of the women had died during the harsh previous winter. According to chronicles at the time, commonly hunted wild fowl such as ducks, geese and swans were eaten. Onions and nuts were probably added for extra flavor. The native Indians arrived with 5 deers. Local vegetables that likely appeared on the table include onions, beans, lettuce, spinach, cabbage, carrots and perhaps peas. Corn, which records show was plentiful at the first harvest, might also have been served boiled and pounded into a thick corn mush or porridge that was occasionally sweetened with molasses. Potatoes, discovered in South America, hadn't arrived to North America at the time. Fruits indigenous to the region included pumpkins, blueberries, plums, grapes, gooseberries, raspberries and, of course, cranberries, which Native Americans ate and used as a natural dye. Cooks didn't begin boiling cranberries with sugar and using the mixture as an accompaniment for meats until about 50 years later. Culinary historians today believe that much of the Thanksgiving meal consisted of seafood, which is often absent from today's menus. Mussels in particular were abundant in New England and could be easily harvested because they clung to rocks along the shoreline. Lobster, bass, clams and oysters might also have been part of the feast. Colonist Edward Winslow describes the bounty of seafood near Plymouth, quote, "Our bay is full of lobsters all the summer and a rich variety of other fish. In September we can take a hogshead of eels in a night with small labor, and can dig them out of their beds all the winter. We have mussels at our doors. Oysters we have none near, but we can have them brought by the Indians when we will," unquote. The feast was never described as a Thanksgiving and as such was probably just celebrated as a traditional English harvest festival. Chapter 5. Canada's Claim to Fame. North America includes Canada, and the English explorer, Martin Frobisher, after finding the Northwest Passage, hosted a Thanksgiving celebration in 1578, quote, "Maester Wolfall, a learned man, appointed by Her Majesty's Council to be their minister and preacher, made unto them a godly sermon, exhorting them especially to be thankful to God for their strange and miraculous deliverance in those so dangerous places," unquote. They celebrated Holy Communion and, quote, "the celebration of divine mystery was the first sign, scale, and confirmation of Christ's name, death and passion ever known in all these quarters," unquote. Years later, French settlers, having crossed the ocean and arrived in Canada with explorer Samuel de Champlain, from 1604, also held feasts of thanks. They formed the Order of Good Cheer and held feasts with the natives. So, where are the origins of Thanksgiving in North America? Maybe, just maybe, the Thanksgiving Feast of 1619, in Virginia, specifically ordered by the London Company, should be considered the origins of the Thanksgiving holiday in North America. Or maybe not. Chapter 6. Were the Spanish responsible for Thanksgiving in North America? According to some experts, the English settlers weren't the first to celebrate a Thanksgiving feast on American soil. The religious Spanish had been sailing to South America and Mexico since the time of Columbus, in 1492. And many experts claim that conquistadors entering North America must have practiced some kind of Thanksgiving at some time. The Texas Society Daughters of the American Colonists claim the very first Thanksgiving was observed by Spanish explorer Francisco Vázquez de Coronado. Accompanied by 1,500 men in full armor, Coronado left Mexico City in 1540 and marched north in search of gold. As the company camped in Palo Duro Canyon in 1541, Padre Fray Juan de Padilla called for a feast of prayer and thanksgiving, beating the Plymouth Thanksgiving by 79 years. Some historians claim that the Spanish founders of St. Augustine, Florida shared a festive meal with the native Timucuan people when their ships came ashore way back in 1565. A second Texas town claims to have been the real site of the first Thanksgiving in America. In 1598, a wealthy Spanish dignitary named Juan de Oñate was granted lands among the Pueblo Indians in the American Southwest. He decided to blaze a new path directly across the Chihuahua Desert to reach the Rio Grande. Oñate's party of 500 soldiers, women and children barely survived the harrowing journey, nearly dying of thirst and exhaustion when they reached the river. After 10 days of rest and recuperation near modern-day San Elizario, Texas, Oñate ordered a feast of Thanksgiving, which one of his men described in his journal. "We built a great bonfire and roasted the meat and fish, and then all sat down to a repast the like of which we had never enjoyed before. We were happy that our trials were over, as happy as were the passengers in the ark when they saw the dove returning with the olive branch in his beak, bringing tidings that the deluge had subsided." Where the very first Thanksgiving occurred, we will never know. But the difficult voyage of the Pilgrim Fathers, in the Mayflower from England to Massachusetts in 1620, with their hardships and struggles in founding a settlement, together with their feast in Plymouth, 1621, with the local native Indians, became a popular tale of adventure, endurance and survival. Chapter 7. Future Thanksgiving Events. Pilgrims held a true Thanksgiving celebration in 1623 following a fast and a refreshing 14-day rain, which resulted in an even larger harvest. This Thanksgiving was significant because the order to recognize the event was from civil authority, Governor Bradford, and not from the church, making it likely the first civil recognition of Thanksgiving in New England. In the late 1630s, the Pequot Indians were blamed for the killing of a white man, leading to the colonizers burning down Pequot villages and killing those who did not perish in the fires. Hundreds of Pequots were killed, leading Governor Bradford to proclaim that Thanksgiving from then on would be to celebrate, quote, "the bloody victory, thanking God that the battle had been won," unquote. The practice of holding an annual harvest festival, or Thanksgiving, did not become a regular affair in New England until the late 1660s. And the date of observance varied in other states. Thanksgiving proclamations were made mostly by church leaders in New England up until 1682, and then by both state and church leaders until after the American Revolution. During the Revolutionary period, political influences affected the issuance of Thanksgiving proclamations. Various proclamations were made by royal governors, and conversely by patriot leaders, such as John Hancock, General George Washington, and the Continental Congress, each giving thanks to God for events favorable to their causes. It wasn't until 1777, during the War of Independence, that all 13 colonies celebrated a day of Thanksgiving on the very same day. The British surrender at Saratoga was a turning point in the war. It showed that the all-power British army was vulnerable and consequently Britain's old enemies, France and Spain, supported the Continental forces. To celebrate the victory over the British, the Commander-in-Chief, George Washington, called for Thursday, December the 18th to be set aside for solemn thanksgiving and praise. In 1789, George Washington, now serving as the first President of the United States, took Congress's recommendation, and called for a national day of thanksgiving and prayer, in gratitude for the end of the War of Independence. It was the final Thursday in November, but was not an official holiday. President John Adams declared Thanksgivings in 1798 and 1799. Thomas Jefferson did not declare any Thanksgiving days during his presidency. He believed in the complete separation of church and state affairs, respecting completely the First Amendment of the Constitution, which prevents the government from making laws which regulate an establishment of religion. However, contrary to popular belief, Thomas Jefferson did declare a Thanksgiving. While serving as governor of Virginia, he declared a day of Thanksgiving and prayer to be held on December 9, 1779. James Madison renewed the tradition in 1814, in response to resolutions of Congress, at the close of the War of 1812. Madison also declared the holiday twice in 1815, however, neither of these was celebrated in autumn. In fact, from the time of the Founding Fathers until the time of Lincoln, the date of observance varied from state to state. Chapter 8. Modern Thanksgiving. Modern Thanksgiving was proclaimed for all states in 1863 by Abraham Lincoln. The Secretary of State William Seward wrote it, and Abraham Lincoln issued it, but much of the credit for the Thanksgiving proclamation should probably go to Sarah Josepha Hale, a prominent writer and editor. She is most famous for writing, Mary Had a Little Lamb. She had written letters to politicians for approximately 40 years advocating for an official holiday which she believed would be a unifying measure to help ease the growing tensions and divisions between the northern and southern states. Lincoln said National Thanksgiving, by proclamation for the last Thursday in November, explicitly in celebration of the bounties that had continued to fall on the Union and for the military successes in the war, and also explicitly in, quote, humble penitence for our national perverseness and disobedience, unquote. However, because of the ongoing Civil War, a nationwide Thanksgiving celebration was not realized until the Reconstruction of America was completed. On January 6, 1885, an act by Congress made Thanksgiving, and other federal holidays, a paid holiday for all federal workers throughout the whole of the United States. But, in 1939, President Franklin D. Roosevelt moved the Thanksgiving holiday 1 week earlier than normal, believing that doing so would help bolster retail sales during one of the final years of the Great Depression. Lou Hahn, general manager of the Retail Dry Goods Association, warned Secretary of Commerce, Harry Hopkins, that the late calendar date of Thanksgiving that year on November 30 could possibly have an adverse effect on retail sales. At the time, it was considered ugly for retailers to display Christmas decorations or have Christmas sales before the celebration of Thanksgiving, a phenomenon today referred to as Christmas creep. This measure led to much upheaval and protest, causing people to call the holiday Franksgiving with an F, and not with the TH. On December 26, 1941, he signed a joint resolution of Congress giving Thanksgiving a permanent observation date, the fourth Thursday in November. It could no longer be changed at the discretion of the president. Nowadays, the centerpiece of the Thanksgiving celebrations remains the dinner. The dinner traditionally consists of foods and dishes indigenous to the Americas, potatoes, stuffing, squash, corn, green beans, cranberries in sauce, and pumpkin pie. And the all-important turkey. But, why turkey? Chapter 9. So, where does the humble turkey fit into the story? Well, it doesn't. It has no relevance in the story. And, it probably wasn't even eaten in the traditional first Thanksgiving dinner in 1621. The wild bird now known as turkey was plentiful in the region and a common food source for both English settlers and Native Americans. But, as mentioned before, during the traditional first Thanksgiving, they most probably ate commonly hunted wild fowl such as ducks, geese, and swans. The turkey bird was never mentioned by the chroniclers, even though the Pilgrim Fathers probably called it turkey. So, why is it named after a country? In a nutshell, it is a case of mistaken identity. Even before America was discovered, Europeans were already eating a wild fowl that they especially liked. It came from Guinea, in Western Africa, and was called a guinea fowl. It was imported into Europe by Turkish merchants and was also popular in England. The English weren't particularly precise about products arriving from the East and were often named after the traders and not the country of origin. Hence, Persian carpets were called Turkey rugs. Indian flour was called Turkey flour. Hungarian carpet bags were called Turkey bags. So, the guinea fowl became popularly known in Britain as the turkey cock or turkey hen. It was the custom for the early settlers to reuse town names from Britain. For example, Plymouth, York, London, Boston are the name of their king or queen, such as Jamestown, named after King James, and Virginia, named after the Virgin Queen, Queen Elizabeth I. So, when the early settlers first saw the American woodland fowl, even though it is larger than the African guinea fowl, they decided to call it by the name they already used, in England, turkey. Chapter 10. Why is turkey so popular at Thanksgiving? Practical reasons have made the turkey the star of Thanksgiving. One of the reasons for the popularity of the turkey is that it is a bird native to North America and is bountiful. They were first domesticated in Mexico centuries before any European set foot on the continent, and it was in the 16th century that settlers brought the fowl birds northward into what is now America. They also took them to Europe, where they were a huge, exotic hit. Also, since turkeys are big, there is always plenty of meat on the table and one bird can feed a whole family, and that makes it easier than sacrificing and cooking a dozen chickens. And chickens are valuable for their eggs. In terms of food production, a dozen chickens can keep eggs on the table for a long time after the Thanksgiving meal is over. Other big animals were also more useful alive than as the main course for a single meal. Cows worked in the fields and, along with goats, they produced milk and, in turn, milk products. Pigs were useful for manure and cleaning up scrubs, they were cheap to keep and it wouldn't make sense killing a pig for one meal with all the resulting pig meat processing that would follow. Also, pork was a very popular food, and if you were looking at putting together a special feast, turkey was a delicious uncommon option. Turkeys were only raised to be slaughtered, and once eaten, you wouldn't miss out on any other product. In fact, Benjamin Franklin wanted the turkey to be the official bird of the United States of America. In a letter to his daughter, he wrote, quote, "I wish the bald eagle had not been chosen as the representative of our country, his is a bird of bad moral character," unquote. He thought the turkey were much more American than the bald eagle and a much more respectable bird. Sarah Josepha Hale played an more important role. In her 1827 novel Northwood, she devoted an entire chapter to a description of a New England Thanksgiving, with a roasted turkey placed at the head of the table. At about the same time, she also began campaigning to establish Thanksgiving as a national holiday in the United States, which she believed would help unify the country as it tumbled toward civil war. Charles Dickens' novel, A Christmas Carol, may have contributed to the popularity as well. When the book was published in 1843, it was hugely popular and it introduced to an American audience the idea of a turkey being a food for a special occasion, Christmas. In Victorian England, the higher classes began eating turkey instead of the traditional goose and it soon became the Christmas must-have meat. Abraham Lincoln's presidency declared Thanksgiving a nationwide holiday. And Lincoln himself started the tradition with an unofficial Thanksgiving dinner that featured his favorite dish, roast turkey. By 1864, organizations across the country made sure that soldiers had turkey to celebrate Thanksgiving no matter where they were. The turkey at Thanksgiving soon became a symbol for togetherness, the family, family values, and friendship. Finally, an important reason turkey has become popular for the Thanksgiving meal is because it has also remained relatively affordable. Although the wild turkey was considered endangered in the early 20th century, its population once again stands in the millions. In addition, modern breeding practices have helped make turkeys both larger and cheaper than ever, thus ensuring their continued place on the Thanksgiving table. One final thought to remember about Thanksgiving in North America. Please take a moment to remember that Thanksgiving didn't come about entirely peacefully. After the Pilgrims, Puritans, and other settlers arrived, years of conflict took place between European settlers and the native Indian people, which resulted in the deaths of millions of native people. The only reason the Pilgrims Fathers could even settle in Plymouth was because the Wampanoag population had been devastated by disease, virtually wiped out by a plague European settlers brought with them years before. Since 1970, people have gathered on the last Thursday in November at the top of Coles Hill, which overlooks Plymouth Rock, to commemorate a National Day of Mourning. Similar events take place in other parts of the country to remember that, even as European settlers fled to North America to escape persecution in their own country, their arrival heralded unspeakable loss for native people that still exists today. Thank you for listening to this Listen to History audiobook. Please leave your thoughts and comments. And don't forget to subscribe, like, and share.